Starting a life in the early 1900s could not have been easy, but that is what Patrick Henry Kane set off to do. Patrick Henry had been a resident of Champaign County since 1878. He was the son of Irish immigrants Thomas and Bridget Kane, and on February 4, 1891, Patrick Henry married Anna Cody. Over a decade after their marriage, Patrick Henry and Anna were interested in relocating. They settled on the outskirts of Philo. At that time, Philo was continuing to develop, and the Canes decided to build their foundation on 160 acres west of Philo. That foundation included a farm, a house, and 8 children. Mary Gertrude was the oldest child, followed by Estella, Henry, Grace, Leo, Anna, Kathleen, and Thomas Matthew. Thomas was the youngest. He was born on January 1, 1911. By the time Tom was born, Patrick Henry had built a new house for the family. The house had 4 bedrooms, a fireplace, hot and cold running water, a cistern to collect rainwater, and lights fueled by liquid gas imported from Detroit. This was very progressive for 1912. In 1916, Tom's older sister, Grace, joined the Dominican Order and became Sister Mary Matthew. Her faith was strong and came from her parents. Patrick Henry always led the family rosary. Tom attended school at St. Joseph's in Philo, where he was taught by the Dominican sisters. While at St. Joseph's, Tom studied hard and he was growing up. He was a very strong young man who would also help his family. Often, he would lend a hand to his brother Leo on the farm. But he also had his adventures where he would chew tobacco or smoke cigars. The older he got, the values that his parents instilled in him strengthened. The faith he had in God grew, and he knew what his calling was, and that was to serve the Lord. On a trip to Champaign with his mom, he whispered in her ear that he was going to become a priest. He was going to set off on a journey to become Father Tom. The journey to become Father Tom was not going to be an easy road, but for Tom, the road started at a Rhode Island university when he enrolled at Providence College. Tom studied at Providence for 2 years. After his time there, it was time to move on to Kentucky. He relocated to St. Rose Priory. After the Priory, he moved on to Somerset, Ohio, where he made profession on August 16, 1931. From Ohio, Tom spent some time at the Dominican House of Studies at River Forest. The journey continued for Tom. A few years later, his goal was realized. He once whispered in his mother's ear that he was going to become a priest. And on June 11, 1937, he was ordained into priesthood at St. Dominic Church in Washington, D.C. One might think Father Tom might be ready to abandon the travel, but that was not in store for him. In fact, it was more travel, not less. This time, he was sent to Switzerland for his graduate studies. He was seeing the world firsthand, but the world was changing very rapidly, and not for the better. Father Tom had traveled to Europe to study. However, throughout the 1930s, Adolf Hitler and the Nazi Party were gaining power, and after 2 semesters of study, Father Tom received a telegram that read, "Return home immediately." He did his best to get out of Europe, and in fact, he did leave Europe, aboard the U.S. President Harding. The U.S. President Harding was heading back to the United States, and they were well on their way. All they had to do was cross the Atlantic. On the evening of Friday the 13th, during the journey back, Captain Roberts of the President Harding received an SOS from a French tanker. All the SOS said was attacked by submarine. Captain Roberts turned the President Harding towards the position given, which was 300 miles off the Irish coast. Once they arrived to the location, they never found the crew from the French tanker. They did notice two British lifeboats floating in the darkness. It was the crew of a British freighter. The crew, which numbered 36, had to leave their ship, which had been attacked by a submarine. The U.S. President Harding took on the 36-member crew and saved them. Merely by chance did they find them at all. As the ship continued on its path back to the U.S., Captain Roberts would begin to receive general alerts about a possible storm, but nothing very specific. With what little he knew, Captain Roberts thought the President Harding could pass to the north and east of the storm. And it wasn't just a storm, it was a hurricane, and the President Harding would take a direct hit from it. The hurricane produced a wave that slammed the President Harding so hard, it swept a member of the crew out to sea. Scores of passengers and crew members had black eyes, bruises, and other injuries. Some of the injuries were extremely severe. Father Tom did what was expected. He carried suffering people to their cabins and reminded passengers to have faith in God. "The storm was the fiercest I ever saw," said Captain Roberts. "It was the most mountainous wave I've ever saw in my years at sea." While the storm battered the ship, it was that one wave that did the most damage. The interior of the ship was transformed into a mass of debris. Nonetheless, the ship survived and did make it to U.S. soil. When it arrived, the flag was at half-mast. The ship deck was piled high with splintered furniture. But when it docked, the passengers got off. Some taken to the hospital. The 36 victims of the British freighter got off. And so did Father Tom. He was back. One of the first things Father Tom did when he was back was notify his family through a postcard addressed to Mr. and Mrs. Patrick Henry Kane. It read, "Dear home folks, got into New York this morning safe and sound. It's a grand and glorious feeling. I hope you're all well." In the years leading up to Father Tom's return to the United States, the Empire of Japan was also taking steps to expand their footprint outside of its immediate borders. They eyed territory from China to the Philippines. Between Nazi Germany and Japan, the world was becoming a very dangerous place. And in 1940, a call for help came from the Spanish Dominicans in the Philippines. They needed assistance. And Father Tom left for Manila. Somebody else had their eyes on Manila as well. The Empire of Japan. As Father Tom was traveling throughout Europe, back home on the farm, life was changing. Patrick Henry and Anna were getting older and moved into the town of Philo. Philo was continuing to modernize, and life would be easier on them living in the town. The new occupants of the farm was their son Leo. Leo married Nellie McCormick, and they would start their own family on the farm. They had four children, Henry, William, Marita, and John. As World War II was about to start, John enlisted into the military and served his country. The world was set for war, and in 1940, Father Tom left for the Philippines. He was sent to the University of Santo Tomas in Manila. His time at the university was dedicated to teaching theology and studying philosophy. On December 7, 1941, Japan launched a sneak attack on Pearl Harbor. The very next day, Japan attacked Clark Field near Manila. Japan was expanding their empire, and on February 22, 1942, General Douglas MacArthur was ordered to leave the Philippines. While these attacks took place, Father Tom foreshadowed these events 1 year earlier in a letter to his younger brother Leo. He wrote, "Probably you often wonder if there will be war between Japan and the USA, and also how the Philippines would fare in such an eventuality. Up to the present, I have thought that war would come, but now I'm not so sure. Japan has everything to lose and nothing to gain by war. In the event it comes, I think the islands will come in for their fair share of special attention." Father Tom also wrote this to his brother Leo on December 28, 1940. He finished the letter with, "I have no intention of leaving." 20 days after Japan attacked Clark Field by Manila, Father Tom would send one more cable to his family. It simply read, "I am well." After that, there was no news. Soon after General Douglas MacArthur left, the infamous death marches would begin. These marches featured three things: torture, starvation, and death. While at Santo Tomas, Father Tom continued to teach and study, and in fact, in 1942, Father Tom earned his doctorate in philosophy. He continued to stay at Santo Tomas until the middle of 1944. That is when the Japanese reached him, and he would take his own turn on the death march, leaving the University of Santo Tomas on his way to Los Buenos. Los Buenos was infamous for its suffering, and it was also known as Hell Camp. Father Tom would see people who were much more physically stronger than him in the Hell Camp die from suffering. He turned to his faith that his parents instilled into him to survive. He would remember what Sister Mary Matthew taught him, that the Lord never gives you more than you can stand. While at the Hell Camp, Father Tom and the prisoners would often pray, and they would celebrate the Eucharist with a particle the size of Father Tom's little fingernail. They would make wine out of raisins by soaking them in water. Father Tom was caught up in World War II and still doing the Lord's work. Back home, the Kane family had no idea Father Tom was still alive. The last message they received from him was on December 30th, 1941. It was now 1944. 3 years had passed, and the family had no idea Father Tom was still alive. The Canes sought out any assistance they could find. They contacted the Red Cross and the Dominican headquarters in River Forest, but they heard nothing in regards to Father Tom's safety. John Kane, Father Tom's nephew, whom was in the Navy, wrote a letter home while at sea in the Pacific that he was within 100 miles of where he thought Father Tom was. Imagine that, having not heard from Father Tom for 3 years and knowing that John was within 100 miles of where he was being held prisoner. That feeling of helplessness had to be overwhelming. But soon, the man who was ordered to leave the Philippines would be returning, and that man was General MacArthur. In October of 1944, MacArthur and his troops landed in the Philippines. On that day, a determined MacArthur made a radio broadcast which he declared, "People of the Philippines, I have returned." It took all the way until February of 1945 for MacArthur and the Allied troops to liberate Father Tom and all the prisoners, but they were free. Word did travel fast back home that Father Tom had been rescued. It started at the News Gazette. A staff writer employed there learned of Father Tom's rescue and was sent to Philo to give the family word of his rescue. It was a Tuesday afternoon, and a reporter arrived at the Kane farm and knocked on the door. Leo Kane answered the door. "I have news of Father Thomas Kane," stated the reporter. There was silence. Leo and Nellie gathered their children, fearing the worst. "Father Tom is alive," the reporter said. Leo stood in astonishment, shaking his head. His children's eyes glowed. Leo and Nellie sent their son Gene to inform Patrick Henry and Anna that Father Tom had been saved. Gene raced in town. By the time night arrived, everyone knew that Father Tom had been saved. It was more than joy that was taking place at the Kane farm with the news of Father Tom's rescue. It was a renewed faith in God. 3 long, dark years had ended, and Father Tom was coming home. In the years after Father Tom's rescue, he had to reacclimate himself to life back in the United States, being surrounded by family and continuing to serve the Lord. However, in 1946, his dad, Patrick Henry, would pass away. Patrick Henry always led the family rosary. He passed away a proud parent, knowing his children were living a life that would make the Lord proud, and he passed knowing that his son Tom was serving the Lord. Father Tom's service of the Lord would continue as he taught at a seminary in Milwaukee, Wisconsin for almost 4 years, and then served as a pastor for the Blessed Sacrament Parish in Madison, Wisconsin for 6 years. But in 1956, the woman whom he whispered that he was going to become a priest, his mother, Anne, passed away. A few years after the death of his mother, Father Tom would find a new home at the University of Dallas. He arrived in Dallas in 1959. When Father Tom started at the University of Dallas, he stayed in the upstairs of Anselm Hall. The first floor was for students. He mentioned that the most rewarding aspect of his life on the campus was his interaction with other students and faculty. Father Tom had only been in Dallas for a few years, and then the unthinkable happened on November 22, 1963.
Here is a bulletin from CBS News. In Dallas, Texas, three shots were fired at President Kennedy's motorcade in downtown Dallas. The first reports say that President Kennedy has been seriously wounded by this shooting. From Dallas, Texas, the flash, apparently official, President Kennedy died at 1 p.m. Central Standard Time, 2 o'clock Eastern Standard Time, some 38 minutes ago.
After learning of the shooting, Father Tom had driven to the hospital. Once arriving at the hospital, Father Tom got out of his car, and he was carrying a tiny piece of the true cross that Jesus Christ was crucified on. President John F. Kennedy had passed away, and he had been given the last rites by another Catholic priest, Oscar Huber. Father Tom had asked Jackie Kennedy if he could take the relic of the cross into the room to bless the president, and Jackie agreed. Father Tom walked into the room and performed a significant act of mercy, anointing the body of President John F. Kennedy. The entire nation was shook to its core through this assassination, but time would pass and the nation would slowly recover. For Father Tom, his time at the University of Dallas would become his joy. He taught philosophy at the university for 25 years. While at the university, Father Tom also founded and built the Dominican Priory of St. Albert the Great, and in 1969, he became its first prior. Today, the priory consists of a 75-person chapel, an activity room, a library, 12 residence rooms, and other facilities such as a dining room and a community room. Between the priory and teaching at the university, Father Tom was very busy. Most of the students and staff came to know him outside of the classroom. He passed out candy, recited limericks, turned his coin purse into a talking frog. He continued to spread joy to whomever he met. One time he was relating his experiences to a group of education majors, and he started talking about his time as a prisoner of war during World War II. "You saw the sorrow in his face," one student said. One thing that Father Tom also learned prior to World War II was the song "The Waltzing Matilda." He learned the song visiting Australia and sang it often on the campus of the University of Dallas. He became known for it. In 1984, Father Tom retired from teaching. He spent 25 years teaching philosophy at the University of Dallas. And in September of 1992, the University of Dallas dedicated a courtyard to Father Tom. The courtyard sits between the Drama Building and Anselm Hall, which was the building he first moved into when he came to the University of Dallas. The dedication ceremony on September 20th, 1992 ended with Father Tom leading the singing of the Waltzing Matilda. In May of 1999, the University of Dallas created the Reverend Thomas Kane Aquinas Award. The award was named for two people. One was Thomas Aquinas. The other was Father Tom. The award is given to a senior philosophy major who meets the requirements of the award. The award is still given today. With the passing of time, Father Tom grew much older and started suffering from colon cancer. He had had a fall that broke his hip, and he also had a stroke. His time was coming to an end. Every day while he was suffering from his ailments, he continued to take Holy Communion. He continued to serve the Lord. Father Tom had been through a lot, and on October 27th, 2000, he passed away. Father Tom gave his life to the Lord, saw the worst and the best that humanity had to offer. He always did the Lord's work and tried to make the world a better place, and he succeeded. Shortly after his death, at the Chapel of the Incarnation on Friday, December 1st, 2000, there was a memorial mass held for Father Tom. There was only one fitting way they could have ended that mass, and that was with the singing of the Waltzing Matilda.
Once a jolly swagman camped by a billabong under the shade of a coolabah tree. He sang as he watched and waited till his billy boiled. You'll come a-waltzing Matilda with me. Waltzing Matilda, waltzing Matilda, you'll come a-waltzing Matilda with me. He sang as he watched and waited till his billy boiled. You'll come a-waltzing Matilda with me. Down came a jumbuck to drink at the billabong. Up jumped the swagman and grabbed him with glee. He sang as he shoved that jumbuck in his tucker bag. You'll come a-waltzing Matilda with me. Waltzing Matilda, waltzing Matilda, you'll come a-waltzing Matilda with me. He sang as he shoved that jumbuck in his tucker bag. You'll come a-waltzing Matilda with me. Up rode the squatter, mounted on his thoroughbred. Up rode the troopers, one, two, three. With the jolly jumbuck that you got in your tucker bag, you'll come a-waltzing Matilda with me. Waltzing Matilda, waltzing Matilda, you'll come a-waltzing Matilda with me. With the jolly jumbuck that you got in your tucker bag, you'll come a-waltzing, you scoundrel, with me. Up jumped the swagman, sprang into the billabong. You'll never take me alive, said he, and his ghost may be heard as you pass by that billabong. You'll come a-waltzing Matilda with me. Waltzing Matilda, waltzing Matilda, you'll come a-waltzing Matilda with me. His ghost may be heard as you pass by that billabong. You'll come a-waltzing Matilda with everybody. Waltzing Matilda, waltzing Matilda, you'll come a-waltzing Matilda with me. His ghost may be heard as you pass by that billabong. You'll come a-waltzing Matilda with me. I'm a waltzing Matilda with me.